When your contract, it lists these 13 different points here. And again, in their plan, what do you see in the Platinum plan they released that mentions any, that mirrors anything that's in yours?
If I'm looking at it, a grant of direct VC money to black investment companies up to $40 billion.
See, a lot of people have been talking about this $500 billion. That's not going to black people. In fact, that's just actually the infrastructure funding program. And so Ice Cube, in my interview with him, he said that, you know, the Trump folks committed to $500 billion in their so-called Platinum plan. Alex, that's total BS. I went through the entire plan. This is a two-page plan. So let's understand. Platinum plan is two pages. Lift Every Voice, Biden, Black America plan is 22 pages. And so the reality is, and I said to Ice Cube, look, what they committed to, there's no commitment. There's nothing substantive behind it.
Much like the opening line of Nas's New York State of Mind, I don't quite know how to start this. We're here to talk about Ice Cube's contract with Black America, or Platinum plan, whatever you want to call it. And there's a lot to say. I don't want to get sidetracked, no matter how tempting. So let's just start at the beginning. Black celebrities such as Ice Cube, Diddy, Charlamagne started a late summer campaign asking both candidates, what's in it for black people? Now, I know I said I wouldn't get sidetracked, but this strategy would have really been useful during the primaries. You know, when there were like 20-something Democratic candidates running, there were debates in town halls every other month. Diddy, Ice Cube, and Charlamagne, black men with social capital and reach, could have hosted a town hall of their own. They chose not to, but I digress.
First, I wanted me to ask, where was Ice Cube during the primary? Where was he in 2018? How do you answer people who say that?
I was being an artist. You know, rapping.
These talks led to Ice Cube releasing his contract with Black America. Although no fan of his approach, I will admit most of the plan has some critical points. His plan mentions things such as criminal justice reform, codifying the 13th Amendment to truly abolish slavery in America, economic growth, etc. While I disagree with some details, I think we can agree on the bullet points. But just this week, Katrina Pearson, a senior advisor of the Trump campaign, announced that she and Ice Cube are proud to announce the Platinum Plan. Before we get into this plan, we must discuss the head scratchers. Ice Cube says Joe Biden's team had no interest in working with him. Yet in a Rolling Stone article written by Jamil Smith, he admits that the Biden team agreed to 85% of the plan, but remained hesitant to make promises they could not keep. He further admitted that the primary goal of the Biden team was to get elected. Well, duh. And that they would talk to him later. Well, duh, they need power first. Cube stated that the Trump team said to him, quote, we saw your contract with Black America and we have a platinum plan. We'd like to pump up our platinum plan. Now this leads to the real head scratcher. Biden's platform, which existed long before the creation of Ice Cube's contract, explicitly addresses most of Ice Cube's issues. So what is this really about? To answer the question, let's do a side-by-side comparison of Trump's platinum plan and the Build Back Better / Lift Every Voice plan of Biden's platform. First off, it's important to know that Ice Cube's contract with Black America is 22 slides long. Donald Trump's platinum plan is two. Platinum plan has four pillars. One, opportunity. Quote, by achieving historic employment levels for Black Americans, as well as increasing access to capital for new businesses, President Trump has been committed to ensuring that all Black Americans can achieve the American dream, unquote. I want to make sure I throw these quotes in here so y'all know I'm not the one saying this bull. Quote, by signing into law the celebrated First Step Act, President Trump has brought common sense criminal justice reform to the American people for the first time in decades, while ensuring that our streets and communities are safe for families and business owners, end quote. Three, prosperity. Quote, as the first president to provide long-term funding to historic black colleges and universities, side eye, this administration continues to seek immediate and generational advancement for Black Americans. I want to point out here that that's not correct. As always, he is exaggerating a statement or not telling the truth. What they did was extend funding permanently for HBCUs, as the funding is set to expire over time. And so they simply had to extend it either on a year-to-year basis or every few years, but they simply extended it permanently. The HBCUs that get that funding weren't going to dry up without it. They weren't going to go defunct like he tried to say. So I just want to point that out here because, again, nothing he says is 100% truthful. It's always some kind of lie to it because he doesn't know how to speak without lying. But anyway, number four, fairness. As demonstrated through his actions to initiate investment into opportunity zones, as well as address health disparities, wage gaps, and necessary education reforms, President Trump works every day to advance a fair and just America for the Black community. End quote. Now, immediately two things jump out with this plan. One, seek infrastructure funding that encourages widespread growth in the annual $500 billion federal contracting opportunities. And two, invest almost $20 billion toward broadband and internet access to create job opportunities, improve classroom connectivity, and the ability to utilize telehealth services. These things stand out for two reasons. The first statement uses the word seek in reference to funding that will lead to widespread growth. And even then, it pledges infrastructure funding that will lead to contracting opportunity. The second bit is a little more interesting. Investing $20 billion towards broadband and internet access is something the Trump administration could have and should have done during this term. After all, we've seen the effects of that through COVID and students having to learn virtually, especially students in areas that don't have strong broadband or internet activities out in rural America. The remainder of this platinum plan contains pretty vague plans. There are statements such as, eliminate long-standing healthcare disparities, increase activity in opportunity zones, including benefits for local hires, champion federal policy reforms to advance homeownership initiatives, but no real details as to how to accomplish any of these things. Furthermore, the Platinum Plan is laden with Republican talking points, but we won't get into those. What I do want to highlight, Trump's Opportunity Zone plan, has resulted in windfalls for billionaires and actually done little to fix inner-city Black communities. Instead, it's actually accelerated gentrification because the residences built were designed to be high-rent facilities. If we can draw any conclusion from the Platinum Plan, and I mean any, it aims to address disparities in the economic growth of African-American community. Now, in contrast, let's take a look at what Joe Biden has to say about this.
We have to be able to put Black Americans in a position to be able to gain wealth. We're going to guarantee first-term homebuyers a $15,000 down payment. For first-term home buyers. In addition to that, what all the studies now show, and I've been arguing this for a long time, is young Black entrepreneurs are just as successful as white entrepreneurs or anyone else given a shot. But you can't get the money. Where do you go to get the startup money? So what President Obama and I did, we had a program where we took $1.5 billion and we invested it in all the SBAs around the country, in the state SBAs, small business associations, and that generated $30 billion came off the sideline, because if you have a guarantee of $200,000 for your new startup enterprise, young entrepreneur, you're going to be able to attract, if it's government money as a guarantee, you'll be able to attract another $100,000.
Biden's plan pledges $50 billion in venture capital to Black and brown entrepreneurs. He also plans to pledge $100 billion to low-interest business loans for Black and brown businesses. The dollar isn't going to fix every issue, though, and Joe's plan invests in cost-free business centers and innovation hubs, see like the one in Birmingham. This will allow Black and brown entrepreneurs to develop their businesses and to find the resources they need. Joe's plan also requires prime contractors to seek out Black and brown small businesses for subcontracting. It also addresses discrepancies within the federal procurement program. Joe's plan goes back to maintaining Black wealth while creating it. The plan addresses homeownership by pledging a $15,000 tax credit to first-time homebuyers. Additionally, he pledges funds towards the revitalization of Black and brown communities. The best part of the plan is how it addresses the pathway to entrepreneurship and homeownership. It acknowledges Black and brown students are disproportionately affected by student loan debt. This plan doubles the federal Pell Grant program while also immediately eliminating $10,000 of student loan debt. This plan also makes 2- and 4-year institutions, as well as private HBCUs, tuition-free for families with income up to $125,000 per year. It's not quite If you're not quite sure about why that's important and how that'll play a role, I'll link to a paper I wrote on this in the description. Maybe even make a video about it later. I don't know. I've been saying that, but I doubt it. Now, if you were to put these two plans on the table, strip away the names behind them, which would seem more enticing to you? Let's take it a step further. If a candidate made this plan available before the other, why would someone say that that candidate has no plan? Finally, we must answer this question. What is this really about? There's no one true answer, but one thing is clear. Black celebrities, for the most part, sit atop Mount Olympus. The day-to-day microaggressions and discrimination that black people deal with, for the most part, don't apply to them. They're in one class that cares nothing about black and brown, only green. Because of this, they think the remedy for racial equality in this country is black wealth. Ice Cube said it himself during an interview with Roland Martin that black wealth is the way to escape racism, which is just patently false. The problem with this is that they totally ignore the barriers that the black community has to deal with when it comes to accumulating wealth. In the times that we have accumulated wealth, what has been the result, i.e. Black Wall Street or any other racial massacre that's existed over time? Since they're one of the few who've made it, they often think that they're special or the chosen ones. Even worse, they think they have the authority to speak for a diverse community. Instead of being the mouthpiece for grassroots efforts of the community, they appoint themselves as the leaders. So in short, this whole thing Ice Cube is doing is centering himself for personal gain. Unfortunately, he's still revered in circles within the black community, so his rhetoric is dangerous. And here's the thing, Ice Cube, Charlamagne, Diddy, they can say these things and they can do these things with almost no repercussions. As time has gone by, you've seen how people have reacted once Ice Cube displayed the smallest hint of regret for doing what he did. The Trump campaign isn't trying to secure the black vote because they care about the black community. They're trying to secure it because they want to win. And if they think Ice Cube is the way to help them do that, then they will. One thing that we have to start asking of black celebrities and celebrity culture overall is to be support and not try to lead. As said before, it's a problem if Ice Cube comes in without all the facts, without all the information, steps on the toes of organizations like Working Families Party or any organizations that have been led by, say, black women or black LGBTQ members, people within the community who are already overlooked. He could be using his voice to amp them up and what they're saying. But for whatever reason, he believes he's the only one who's considered the things that he's put forth. One good thing about the Trump presidency is I think it made people more engaged. It made people understand how politics works and what it takes to get things done. There are a lot of people who still don't know, and that's fine. It still takes a lot of us to learn and grow and to hold each other accountable when we say or do the wrong things or when we don't quite know what we're talking about. Hopefully, this presidency will be coming to its end here in the next few months. And if it does, then the one thing we have to do with the Biden administration is to ensure that they know that winning and putting these plans out there simply isn't good enough. They have to enact them. And we need to use whatever power that we can develop, whether it's through state legislatures, the House of Representatives, the Senate. We have to use all of those tools to continue holding him accountable.
Let's do everything that we can to make sure that everybody we know comes out to vote. Cenk, you mentioned that the polls look good. They do. They look good for Hillary Clinton as well. So anyone who thinks that Biden is a shoo-in is dead wrong. This is going to be a tough race. And we got to do everything we can in the next 2.5 weeks to win it. Day after Biden wins, let us rally the American people, working class people, people of color, young people, all people who believe in justice around a progressive agenda.
The path to equality for black communities and black Americans is not simply by throwing money in whatever form you want to throw it in. When people talk about reparations, it also requires the removal of barriers. These are things that must be removed in order for the black community at large to be successful. It must not be an obstacle to go from impoverished or poverty to the middle class, as it is now, especially as a black American. When your schools are underfunded, when you're unable to secure an additional education or education beyond high school so that you can have the certifications or degree necessary to get a well-paying job. When you're a parent or a family that makes minimum wage or just above minimum wage for those reasons, and you have a child and you're unable to send that child to daycare without it breaking the bank, and so the child maybe has to go to a family friend. And maybe they're good at keeping the child, but maybe they're not able to teach the child in a way that their white peers or middle-class peers will be able to be taught. And so they're at a disadvantage when they get to pre-K and kindergarten and first grade. And as a conversation we had with Representative Greg Kennard here in Georgia, if a student is behind at third grade when it comes to reading level, then you can pretty much chart how successful they'll be education-wise. And those are the things that we have to tackle from the ground up. So while Ice Cube has a big picture idea, it doesn't do enough to tackle the issue at heart. That's it for our video today. We appreciate you all tuning in. Make sure you subscribe to the channel. Like the video if you did. We really, really appreciate you tuning in. Give us your feedback. Make sure you tune into Don't Call Us a Podcast live on our YouTube every single Thursday, where we talk about not just politics, but we talk to local candidates and statewide elections and municipal elections and really show the importance of voting on all levels. KidsWearCrowns.com is the website. Follow us on Twitter at the KWC blog. Everybody have a great and wonderful day.